let's get back to types. So, right. Hmm? Okay, so let's. Yes.
So you're using some
different reports. Yeah, I can recheck that in a little bit.
Okay.
Yeah. So, yep.
I've got a question regarding identity.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe it's very stupid, but
no, no.
Why do we have family for all A to A and not simply A?
For all A to A and not simply A? Because so essentially think of it this way. This part is, so the whole thing is like the, this is the dependent function space. And the thing on the left, it says, I'm gonna take an A of type star and give you back a function from A to A. And then the identity, like in Haskell, it is type A to A, but the for all is implicit. Does that answer your question?
And so in Haskell, the highlighted, you pronounce it as kind.
Yes, yes. So informally, during the talk, I was calling it kind. Formally speaking, yeah, it's not one. Yes, yeah. And then again, and in Haskell, because it can only, it's always one star. Yeah, so then because of that, you just say for all A in Haskell. Even if you wanted to be explicit, you don't explicitly say for all A of kind star. Yeah, here we are maximum specificity. And here for our next challenge, let's see what happens if we give this function itself as an argument. We want to do id in Haskell syntax. So what would be its type is the question. So, well, we can't do that because that's not a valid, ID is not a valid argument on its own to ID, right? So we need to give it something else first.
Actually, why is it the case that ID is not a valid argument? If the type is for all A of any type, but A to A is also a type.
Yeah.
So why is that not a valid
argument? Because we don't have implicit arguments. So. Yeah.
It's just a limitation, right?
Okay. Yes, yeah, exactly. Technically, yeah, I mean, otherwise it's very valid. But so it's a good exercise though to kind of see if you're how what needs to be given to it. So does anyone want to do an attempt to make this type check?
So in this type that you have here, do you want the second ID to be the X or to be the Y?
Good question. Yeah, the second ID is Y, and it has type X.
Yeah, okay, so that's why ID doesn't work because you have to fill in X first.
Yes, yeah, so, and essentially, is it obvious what we're putting into the X? Yeah, exactly. For all A to star dot A to A. And then, yeah, this big thing, it wants us to give it ID now, which we do. And we get back ID in this representation. Okay, let's do one more, and then we can look at data types. So we could do a const function. Let const equals, is this obvious to you guys? Yes. Yep. Good question. Yeah, I can do like I tend to put the types to the left, but you could do it either way. I'm pretty sure, because it doesn't matter. They're both living on the same level. So let const equals lambda a b. And then, let's see, cd, and then of type.
Would it make more sense to do it like TA, TB, A,
Oh yeah, TA, TB, good one. And then this has type. Oops. And then we give it. Yes, for all TA of star, TB of star, and then A of type TA, and then B of type TB. And I hope there's no syntax error. Damn it.
You still need the result type.
Oh, of course, yeah, you're right, yeah. TA to TB to TA.
Oh, right, yes.
Okay, well, trivial error somewhere. Let's see. We've done this. Does anyone see it? H5 for all A star, B star, A to B to A. That should be correct. This is type error, so syntactically this is correct. So we have TA of type star, yep. TB of type star.
But isn't it just that you're returning TA because the arguments TA and B are in for all?
No? That I'm returning TA? You mean here?
Yeah.
You have to have like twice for all because like the first
time. Oh, yeah, you're right. Wait. Oh yes, wait. I think we don't need this. What was it?
Yeah. But wouldn't it also have been correct if you just give back TA?
Give back TA. Oh yes. Let's try that. Hopefully. You're right. Yeah. Cool. Sweet. So can do. We can do. Okay, so without data types and not going through church encoding, you know, we can do these kind of combinators. But it's not terribly exciting. So for the next lecture, we're gonna start adding some more things.
The last two things, why are they the same? Or how
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So in the either you write I expect something TA, which is a proper type, because you say it has type star, and then a TB, and then you say I will return something of a function of type TA to TB to TA, right? And that's just the same as saying like, well, I expect something for all TA, and then you explicitly enumerate all of the things that you were expecting, and then you say it will return TA. And so the for all is like a dependent type, and then but if you don't need dependency, so writing out TA to TB is just a non-dependent type. The for all.
Mm-hmm.
And so the for all, there you can explicitly name your things and then use them later on. But if you don't need to need to be able to refer to it, you can just write it after the dot and just use the non-dependent type version. Is that making sense?
Yes, yeah, that's really good. You're very good at this.
In the first case, we have like partially applied this. This first part,
right? There are two kind of syntaxes
mm-hmm.
to give the type of a function, and you have the dependently typed version, which is like with this
mm-hmm.
Double colon for all, and
yep.
You just have the arrow, and the arrow is the non-dependent type version of it. But if you write for all TA, that means it's something that expects a TA. And then expects a TB and then an A, and so it's exactly the same as this arrow.
tells me when you write the first version that actually, like, something in the code is actually inferring the type of this TA arrow TB arrow TA?
No, you explicitly put it, you say A has type TA.
No, no, in the first version. There you don't write it, right?
Then, yeah, then well, because you also have that,
you've written it there.
Yeah. So you know that TA has type star, so you already know some information about it.
Yeah, but there you haven't written it, at least compared to like the next one, because there you explicitly write A.
So here we're referring also to the term of type TA. So here we're just saying we have something of type TA, but we don't give it a name. And because in the case of, you know the paper theorems for free. There's really, in principle, not much you can put there. There's very few things you can do with it, which is essentially nothing. All you can do is just, that's all it could be, is this thing A. So it's essentially nameless here.
I think it's...
Yeah.
In both cases, you write down, here is something of type TA,
mm-hmm.
But in the second case, you also give it a name.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is that similar when you like bring in the dependent type?
It's not even like anything. When you say bring it into the context, which one?
When you're trying to like do something, it's like with the for all, it's there, but you don't have access to it. But when you have it in on after the dot, then you have access to it or something like that.
After the dot is your dependent function range, where this is the thing we're doing something with, and essentially we're describing a relation between these types and these values. So normally in Haskell, if you just imagine this part, like that would be a valid thing in Haskell, TA, TB, TA. So that's a relationship between three types. Dependent types allow us to name the specific values. So now we have a relationship between the types and the values. For this case, we don't need to. We can just do it this way. It's that simple enough. But if we were doing something like more complicated, like once we get to, once we get to vectors, which is the type of lists with a number, and then we're gonna have functions like append, which takes in a vector of size n and a vector of size m, and then we can in here we can say that the size of the output vector is going to be n plus m. So
that's what I meant.
Yes. Then that's what it is. Except in this case, this is also a valid way. They're syntactically equivalent. It's just one is the regular function type which we've used, and this is the new version of doing it.
Can we do even move for alls? Can we have for alls somewhere else? In other words, can we have a higher round types?
Yes, you should be able to. You could use them within each other, yeah, because this whole thing is also a term, so you could, let's see, assume A of type star, and then let B equals just some kind of function from A to const. Would that be, A to const, do we need to name this? Essentially, if you think of A to const, then I mean, here we have const has type for all, and it's within the expression. I think I need to type it. Oops. Oh, no.
You missed the.
Oh, yeah. Right. No? Do I need brackets around it? I don't think so. Const. Type in for all, type expected star. My missing it? Where is the type error? Let's see, what could it, what is it? Oh wait. Shoot. Oops. Oh no. Okay. So what's something else? Lambda A. Oh, of course. Yeah, wait. I get it, because we...
two
yes, exactly. Lambda A to ID star A. That one? No. Oops. Yeah, lambda T ID for all X star star. So ID needs to get two things. Let's give it lambda, okay, that's valid. And then now we want to use a lambda instead of the not. So we do lambda x to id star x. That'd be valid.
Doesn't the lambda always need a type signature?
Yes, okay. For all x of type star. So it's type star, and then it's gonna have x of type star. We have what is this star? Should no x. Yeah, because no. Shit. Right. For all x of type star.
Maybe we can try a simpler example.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if that's simple, by the way, but what comes to mind is that if we take an ID function,
yeah,
and let's apply it to, we have natural numbers, do we have booleans in this core language?
No, but we can assume something. We can, well, we have naturals actually, wait, yeah.
Naturals, do we have something else? So, you know, we can form a tuple of ID applied to one, for instance, and ID of applied to true. Then we should have a rank two type, right? Correct?
ID applied to 1 and ID applied to 2?
If we form a tuple of, let's say, ID applied to 1 or no?
We don't have tuples as a primitive, yes. Mm-hmm. Probably types. So we can maybe discuss that on the break?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, sure, yeah. That's cool. Okay, well, yeah, so natural numbers, what are they? If we want to implement functions on natural numbers in like Pascal or whatever, you know, we can implement a fold and then express our functions as folds. In this case, though, where we want to work, we're going to want to generalize that to the dependent type version. So we're going to use eliminators. So the way this works is that you define for your whenever you define a type. So we're going to like right now define naturals the same way we defined all the other types. And in addition to our constructors, the type constructors, the data constructors, we need to define an eliminator, which is like, think of it as a dependent generalization of a fold. So what it means is that first you have, the first argument to it is, it's called the motive. it's kind of like, what are we doing? What's the goal of this computation? It needs to, for all m of type NAT to star, essentially, because it's going to take in a NAT as an input, because this natural one, and the star could be anything that would be any output type of this computation that we want to do. And then we need to give it the function. So this is, think of it as like the pattern matching case. We need to give it a function for dealing with zeros, and we need to give it a function for dealing with the successor case. And this one is essentially we're encoding the inductive definition is that given for all L, given ML, we want to put the M on the outside and then success L. So we're catamorphosizing through the natural number. And yeah, then we get the, as an output, we have this type of for all K, not dot MK. And
sorry, did we already define naturals as this type system?
Maybe I should have started with the definition. Okay. Right. So here is the typing constructors for naturals. Like again, maybe refreshing to see something so simple. Here, you know, we assume that naturals. We can derive naturals in any context, just without anything. And then we assume that zero just exists in its own type natural. And then the successor case where if we want a successor k, we need to be given something like k of type not, and we get successor k. I'm sure maybe who hasn't seen the definition of naturals inductively? Or
the purpose of defining not as a constructor kind of to use like lambda encoding?
This goes back to the point about Church encoding I've made earlier, is that we could, like naturals are a very simple type, we could define them using Church encoding, but it doesn't scale that well to once you're working with dependent types. So in this methodology, we're just going to define all of our base types using the eliminator approach. It's just a bit nicer. Yes. Yeah. So it was kind of good practice to for when you wanna implement it, and then if you implement data types, then you can implement them internally within the language. I thought it's a better exercise than just murking with Church encodings for a few hours. You haven't seen inductive definition. So essentially. It's very simple. We want to define numbers when we have nothing. So the way we do that is even in Haskell, you'd say data not equals zero and then s not. So it's a definition which first you have zero, and then you can put it into here into S, and then you have S zero which represents one, and then you can derive S zero zero and keep going. So you can represent every natural number this way, and that's just the.
You want multiple S's, not multiple
Z's. Sorry, yeah. S Z S S Z. Yeah. Yeah. So this is just the pretty much like the same thing, just in a different syntax. So yeah, and then using this, you have evaluation, and the type not evaluates to not, then zero evaluates to zero, and then if we have, so if we're looking at this, then you know we're going upwards. You know, to evaluate successor k to successor l, we assume that k evaluates to l. So we assume that the thing on k and l are valid numbers, and k values to l. I mean, at the moment we're not doing much, but like you can imagine that there's an equation within like successor a plus b evaluates to successor l. So just like a recursive way of doing evaluation, recursive definition of evaluation. And we have the evaluation of the eliminator. Seems a little bit complicated. Let's see. Essentially, we're describing a fold, though. So that's kind of it's kind of like the thing here. It's seems complicated, but just think of it as a fold, and then we'll get back to it once we're implementing it. But we also have the tapping of the eliminator. So let's see, where's the best? So first we start with the motif, M of type not to star. So that's like the first thing we give. The second thing is MZ, which is the case for zero. So here we have, what is the case for zero means? If we have something of type M0 and that evaluates to T, then we know that this M0 has type T. So for example, let's say we're doing a function to booleans, like we're doing odd or even. So then the motif would be not to bool. And then we would have, we have a function which evaluates to true or false. And then that's what would be the type of MZ. From natural to bool. And then the last one is we give the recursive condition. Similarly, it would be a little bit more difficult, but essentially where it's like in a verbose way of defining the recursive case where we're gonna, we'll see the limitation, but yeah, when you're gonna keep going, putting the M outwards and then going inwards into the term K and then taking it apart until you reach zero. I think it'd be much easier once we build something with it, maybe it'll help. Essentially for all L of type not MK to M successor L that evaluates to T tau. So that's the evaluation of the type. And we know that MS, which is the function we're gonna give, not a limiter when we're using it, we're gonna give it this function MS and a function MZ. And this function MS needs to have this type essentially in order to be a valid function. And if it has this type, it means that we can use it when we're performing our fold-like computation. So essentially, Once you have some code, let me show you. It's a little kind of too abstract. Prelude PL. So, oops. Copy. Okay. Here's the definition of plus. So we give the motive, and we give the case for zero, and we give the case for successor. So in the motive case, we need an additional natural parameter. So let's look at the predicate because it has predecessors, so it has even fewer things. So we have the motive is just so because the input is natural and the output is natural. So we have this function from something to not. And then what happens if we do predecessor of zero? In natural case, we just do zero. And then if we do the predecessor of non-zero, then we essentially we break it down and just give the number stripped away of its successor. So and these so it's, these are the three functions. So one describes the kind of the what values we're giving it, and what type we're gonna get back, and one describes what to do with zero in this case, and one describes what to do with the successor. And of course, if we added something else, so in this case we only have one lambda underscore, but if we had lambda underscore and then not, then because it's dependent types, then we know we need to give more information here. So instead of zero, which has zero arguments in this case, now it has one argument, which is the second number we're adding to. Or in this case would be n equals, so if in Haskell, you can imagine that what this would correspond to the pattern matching case for zero and then n and equals n. So that's an intelligent way of writing it, well, in the Haskell version. So the zero is implicit here, and then this is the n of the input, it's represented here, and this is the n which is the output, which would be here. So this computation, if we actually gave it a zero and an n, it would know to use this function. It's essentially like a verbose way of doing pattern matching. You have a function to which you give two functions rather than it doing the case breaking down for you. Suppose that this would be a nice kind of addition, is that an alternative thing to do would be to have pattern matching, and then you can take care of all this automatically. And this would be the successor case in Haskell, where you just have your
What is P?
Successor P rec. Good point. Is it three? Where did I make that note? Let's see. Okay, let's have a look at here. So we just look at its type. So it would be the it would be in the where is it? So this is the MS case. So then we just have to look at MS, and then
first argument of MS.
Yes.
Is A.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Exactly. So that's the type argument. So in this case, it would just be not because we're doing that. So we don't care about it because that's kind of implicit. If we were working with like a dependently typed, it's all dependent type, but if something that needs a dependent type, then we could refer to it. Because we don't need to, as you can see here as well, we kind of don't think about it. Can also define a simpler, more familiar fold using this approach. So, again, it can be a little bit tricky to read. But yeah, I suppose could look at how that's implemented. Hopefully that clarifies things and doesn't confuse things further. Let's see. So evaluation of natural nation. So oops, we put that here and we put that here. Oops. Evaluation. Right. Okay. So, let's see. So, mzval, which is the value of the thing that takes care of the zero case, is we do cval of mzd, and then if we look at cval, for naturals, that's going to put us here. So it's just, you know, goes from 0 to 0, and then the evaluation successor case, again, does the recursive evaluation, and then eval. So essentially, it looks into the recursively into the parameters MZ and MS and simplifies them, and then we get the value, and then we recursively go through and we see what's inside the value, and if it's a zero, then we just return it. And if it's a successor, then we apply msval so to k, and then in the case of the neutral value where something went wrong, then we're kind of stuck in there, and we have the neutral case, or you know, get the internal error, and then we define the let in the recursion. So essentially, this says that we recursively apply the we look at our number, and then we, if it's a zero, then we just apply the zero function, and then that's the answer we get. And if it's not a zero, then we apply, keep recursively applying it until it gets to zero. And that's like your catamorphism. And then, let's get rid of it. Is that sense, I hope. Let's see if there's any more examples we can have a look through. Let's see, not of them, not them. Oh yeah. No. Mm-hmm. Right, let's look at another example. And then maybe once you've seen two of them, the kind of the pattern will make more sense. So vectors we can define in a similar way. So the vector type, we have for all A, so for all types, and for all K of type not, for all numbers, we get a type which is vector AK of type star. And to construct it, we have two ways, nil and cons. And you know, same as list has nil and cons in Haskell, but again, we have to do the whole signature in this case. So nil has type for all A of type star, vector A, zero. And cons has type that you take your type and then you take your natural A, and then so this variable tells you how big the next vector is, and then you take a vector of the size you've just said you're going to take. Type, and then vector has that type, and then so the important thing is you have k in this vector size, and then you have successor k in the next one. So here we have there was a question earlier about a relationship between the two terms. We're saying that this value, successor k, is related to k. It's going to be one more. Right. So here we also define the eliminator for that, which again, very, very similar principle. Now there's a few more things coming in. We give it a case, so we give the motive, and the motive has to go for all a k not vector a k to star. So takes in some kind of term which evaluates to this, and then takes the zero case, and then takes the recursive case. And you know, recursing through a list is very similar to recursing through a number. You just keep so every time you take the next step, you increase the size, increase the number, and you add you do the cons. So again, you can see the relation here. So in this cons is of size L, and that means the combined list is going to be of size L plus 1, hence we're successoring. And the output is going to be this type, which is what we want. So we can look at vectors in the implementation. And again, regular vector, just cursely evaluate. And then again, we give this recursor to go through each cons application in the vector we're given. Could also have a look at the typing. So if we have not, inferring type of not, and then, oops, I forgot to plug it in. No, wait, shit.
What does that represent, this neutral case?
Neutral? Oh yeah, neutral means we're stuck in there. So it would mean that...
How is it happening when you have
only two constructors? Only the constructors? Oh, we still have our all of our previous constructors as well. But you can get stuck if hopefully you'd prevent any expression which kind of just thinking out loud. If you make an expression which will get you stuck, hopefully your type checker would stop you before that. Most of the time, unless you know, in practice, it'd be a very 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 obscure expression. But in principle, I suppose it's possible that, especially because we don't have like a, technically we have an inconsistency in because we're using type to type, then it's possible you could do some weird term which brings you to a situation you can't leave. If you didn't have a type checker, then a stuck term would be something like 3 applied to 3. Yeah, that's nonsense, but of course we're not going to be able to have that, but... Yeah.
If you're written on the compiler, this is like good enough to have just throwing errors on the first step. But if you're doing some kind of tooling, maybe you want to keep going after the first error and try to figure out, you know, things that, whatever, you can parse it and just at the end just say, oh, you have all of this.
I suppose, yeah, you could, so we're using a very, very simple monad to represent this. We're just, the result monad, yeah, it just takes the first error. I suppose, yeah, you could do a list. I guess in practice, it would depend on what you're doing, because if you couldn't parse it, then you can't type check it. Sometimes, yeah.
Let's make a break.
Okay, yeah. But yeah, I can ask the question in front.
One more thing. I've seen your screen going...
Oh, it's just once, and because I forgot to plug it in.
Oh, but it was off right now. Right?
Yeah, that was it. So.
Oh, because that breaks the recording.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah.
So, is it working now?
Well, if I start it again.
Right. Cool.
Time for a break.
Okay.
Oh no! So whenever you disconnect
the screen,
it stops.
Yes.
Yes.
Oh. You're still recording to the
year. Upload the slides.
Like, when it loses the signal, it pauses because there's nothing to record, and then it doesn't start because it's waiting.
Oh, damn it.
You can do like a low, like afterwards, you can go from like 6 o'clock to 10 o'clock, you can do it alone, and then you hit the record.
Yeah, you can do it again.
Like, but nobody listens to it, so it's like.
Sounds like an excellent idea.
Maybe some kind of example of this kind of work.
Uh-huh.
Some kind of paper.
Paper?
Yeah, yeah.
What you mean with multiple errors?
Yeah.
Not off my head, but I suppose. What's your implementation like? Like how far? What is your like monad you're using or?
So for example, I was working on a plugin for IntelliJ, and they have support to. Not sure how they call it, but you know, in the editor you don't want to stop highlighting. Just
right. Yes. Yes. That makes sense.
And they have some kind of support to. You can continue parsing,
mm-hmm.
so you don't have the types, but you have
yes.
Some kind of BNF syntax to
mm-hmm.
That you want to check.
Yeah.
And they have some kind of support that you can continue after the error, and
yeah.
you know, you will still have highlighting, but
yeah.
Put a squiggly line where you see the error.
That makes sense. So
it's not really easy to.
okay.
So if you remember something.
Not a paper specifically on this, but if you imagine that when you're evaluating your thing, for example, you have let's say you have your application, and then you split it, and you want to simplify both parts. So, and then let's say there's an error in one, so then you save this error, but the other ones you just keep going until they stop, and either evaluate or they also give you an error.